I really like this picture. It tells me a lot about you, about me, about humanity. And if you understand its meaning, it can change your life. It can slow down your biological clock. You could provide the best possible start for your children's health prior to conception. And in particular, you could improve your own health, which is what we're going to explore now. I once heard that if you want to know how you might eventually die, you should look at what your ancestors died of. It scared me to think about it this way because one of my closest relatives, my grandma, died from colorectal cancer. Does it mean that I die from cancer? What about you? What is your prediction based on your ancestors? I was 15 years old when my grandma was diagnosed. That time, I had no clue what was going on. My grandma was born the same day as me. We used to spend a lot of time together. We were best friends. And I remember one day cooking vegetable soup for my grandma for the first time in my whole life when my mom left me with grandma on my own one afternoon. And then a couple of days later, I found myself standing by the door of her room, looking into her eyes and saying goodbye, knowing that I would never see her again. It was painful, as it always is when you lose someone who you really love. And I was the kid who always asked why. And I couldn't comprehend how a strong woman, how my grandma, could turn to skin and bones so rapidly within a few months, not be able to even get out of her bed, and then suddenly be gone. So I had a need to understand it, so I studied. I did my biology degree, then genetics and molecular biology degree. During my studies, there were the cancer cells that I blamed for killing my grandma. And over that period of time, I came across research that completely changed the way I looked at health and diseases. Science kind of programmed us to think about our DNA, which is good because now most of the people know that they have DNA, that they have genes. But at the same time, we learn to blame our genes for most of our health problems. I often hear people say, "This is my family history," or "This is because of my genes." Almost resigned in the fact that it's something inevitable, something we cannot change. But are we telling the whole story? Let me show you how our genes represent just one chapter of the story, and there is another chapter that you all write for yourself. Professor Sandy Tugo from the University of Leeds conducted research with 21,000 people over the age of 50. And what they did, they looked at lifestyle and health of these people and lifestyle and longevity of their parents. And one of the main findings was that lifestyle of parents at the time these people were 10 years old explained 31 to 78% of their adult health. And these researchers show that when parents didn't exercise, these people didn't exercise when they grew up. When parents were obese, the people tended to be obese when they grew up. When parents smoked, the people tended to be small when they grew up, and so on. So it looks like we tend to follow habits of our parents, and then we will end up with very similar health. In other words, we could say that we learn to live in very similar or same environment as our parents. And this happened to Jane, so I would like to tell you her story. Jane was born as a relatively healthy kid with working genes, but her parents didn't lead a particularly healthy lifestyle. And as Jane grew up, she adopted habits of her parents. Among these, Jane learned to eat mostly pre-cooked food and fast food. She would often crave sweets and food when she felt stressed because her mother tended to give her treats every time she was upset, and she used food as a reward. And just like her parents, she didn't do exercise regularly. And although you might think that these factors are not important and very small, these are negative factors in Jane's environment that are affecting her body on a daily basis for a prolonged period of time, years. And this environment led Jane to becoming obese in her 30s and being diagnosed with type 2 diabetes in her 40s. But because Jane's father had type 2 diabetes, Jane blamed her genes and just accepted the situation. And as time went by, suddenly, in late 50s, Jane was diagnosed with breast cancer. And this time, Jane knew that her aunt died from breast cancer. And after testing, she realized she had BRCA gene mutation, mutation which is associated with higher risk of developing breast cancer. So this information gave Jane understanding why she was diagnosed. But then something happened. Jane came to learn that her neighbor had been diagnosed with breast cancer, but his lady didn't have BRCA gene mutation. And when she went to the hospital for a treatment, she met identical twins with identical genes, and one of them was there for breast cancer treatment, while the other one was completely healthy and came to support her sister. This made Jane think, could there be something else other than her genes that might be contributing to her health problems? And the answer is yes. An answer might not surprise you at all, because the answer is her own environment. But that's nothing new at all, because now we have massive epidemiological evidence on link between, you know, our environment and diseases. Based on these studies, we know what factors in our environment are negative and are increasing our risk of diseases, and we know what factors are positive and are decreasing our risk of diseases. So I think you all know what you would advise Jane to do. If Jane had a better diet, if she took up on exercise, lost weight, if she would reduce her stress levels, she could significantly reduce her risk of getting type 2 diabetes despite her father's diagnosis, and also reduce her risk of breast cancer despite having BRCA gene mutation and aunt who died from breast cancer. But the question is, how does this work? What do you actually do to your body when you eat healthy, when you move, when you exercise, when you reduce stress levels? Well, now we have plausible mechanism to explain how such an innocent thing as diet or exercise can make a dramatic impact on our health. So let's have a look at it. If you imagine yourself as a TV screen, for a TV screen to work, we need TV channels and remote control that can turn on and off these TV channels. And our bodies work like this too. So for our body to work, we need DNA. And our DNA has actually two parts. It has genes, which are TV channels, but it has also remote control, which are regulatory parts of our DNA. And even though in real life it's much more complicated, it works in very similar principle. By pressing buttons on your remote control, you can turn on your channels, your genes. But we cannot press all the buttons all the time. Some of these buttons are blocked. The process of blocking is called methylation, when we add a metal group, stop mark, on certain buttons on our remote control. And when we have the stop marks there, we cannot press that button, so we cannot turn on our channel, our gene. But this is good, because this is the way how our body regulates that in different type of cells, we are turning on different channels. And so at this point, you should understand that our DNA contains not just genes, but also remote control. And I would like you to remember three things about your remote control. First one, that initially how your remote control looked and where you had placed your stop marks was given to you before you were born, while you were developing in your mother's womb, and your mother had the biggest impact on how your remote control was initially set. But the second thing I would like you to remember is that at the present moment, your remote control doesn't look completely the same. And we have now amazing studies with twins, especially from researchers such as Dr. Fraga or Dr. Siegel and many others, that we know that with time, our remote control can change. And what I mean that it can change, we can add or remove stop marks from our remote control. And now we even understand that as we age, we gradually lose the stop marks from our remote control. And the third thing I would like you to be aware of, that people with diseases such as cancer, cardiovascular diseases, or type 2 diabetes have remote control looking different than healthy people. And what is different about their remote control is that they are missing stop marks at some places where we need them, and they have added stop marks at the places of their remote control where we don't want them to be. And what we now start to understand is how this mess in our remote control and where we have placed our stop marks is happening before we manifest diseases, and how it is linked with developing diseases. And the question is, why I'm telling you all of this? Because why I'm bothering you with all this molecular biology? Because the important question to ask here is, what is it that can change how your remote control looks and can change where you have placed your stop marks? Because that plays a crucial role in what's going on with your TV channels, how you can turn them on, and what's happening with your whole body TV screen. And we have now solid evidence from animal studies and growing number of human studies that show that changes on our remote control are triggered by our environment. So exposure to nutrition, exercise, stress, pollution, chemicals, whatever you want to think about, it all can change how our remote control looks and where we have placed stop marks. And why is it that fascinating? Because that means the fingers on your remote control is your own environment you can choose for yourself. And so when we come back to Jane and her environment, based on epidemiological evidence, we know what factors in our environment are decreasing the risk of diseases. So we know what positive factors we would advise Jane to include in her life. But now we start to understand what these positive factors can do, that they interact with our remote control and can change where we have placed our stop marks. And from some initial evidence in human studies that we have, what we could advise Jane to do. So for instance, based on Dr. Zhang's studies, we know that if Jane did 26 to 30 minutes exercise a day, she could keep more stop marks at the right places on her remote control than when she would do just 10 or less minute exercise a day. And also there are other studies from the same research group showing that diet high in fruit and vegetables, it also has this protective effect, while typical Western diet doesn't have this effect. And we have studies from Dr. Huang, for example, who shows that the remote control people who are obese looks different than the remote control people who have weight. And if Jane did lose weight, as it showed in Dr. Huang's study, she could make her remote control look back as in a healthy person. And last, I just mentioned a study about the prevention of breast cancer. Based on Dr. Bryan's study, if Jane would actively do exercise, she could make her remote control, she could actually protect her remote control and prevent stop marks being added into those places in her remote control, that when they are blocked, they contribute to development of breast cancer. But what is initial thing, very first thing Jane would have to do to reduce her risk of diseases? She would have to change habits that she adopted from her parents and followed for a prolonged period of time. So I would like to ask you, what about you? What habits of your parents do you follow? What example are you setting for next generation? How does it affect your remote control and their remote control? And even though there is nothing as 100% risk reduction of diseases, as you can see, it's not all just about our genes. Because our DNA contains not just genes, but also this remote control. And both our genes with remote control work in a beautiful synchrony with our environment. And so you all have a choice. You can choose your environment, and by that you can influence your DNA. Because you can influence your own remote control, where are placed your stop marks, and this way you influence your genes regulation. And yes, for all those skeptics out there, this research still has many gaps, but researchers are still exploring it. But what researchers have already found is a solid base upon which we can start to act. And apart from amazing opportunities for earlier diagnostics and new treatments that are already researched in many world centers, this information gives even bigger justification for why what we do on a daily basis matters so much. Why prevention is possible and so important. And also it provides realization that we have more control over our body or our health than we think we have. And when we come back to this beautiful illustration, this illustration is called epigenetics. And you just learn its basics. Epi means above. Epigenetics is something which is above genetics, above our genes, which oversees how our genes work. And this picture shows that you are all creators, and it's not a metaphor. You all have a capacity to direct your health because you all hold your remote control and you can choose your environmental fingers. And by that, you influence your TV channels, how they are turned on. And ultimately, you influence your whole TV screen, how it works. Thank you so much.